Greetings, fellow nerds. It's time for the August edition of Q&A with NurdRage. First, some channel news. Big shoutouts to these new big sponsors on Patreon. Emil Mikulic, Simon Bitdiddle, Cullen Purkis, and Samuel Pelzer. Thank you very much for your contributions. And okay, let's get right to the questions. So Sean Rickman asks, is it possible to reclaim the platinum and palladium from a used catalytic converter? It's absolutely possible to recover platinum and palladium from used catalytic converters. I'm just not sure if an individual can do it profitably. Economies of scale tend to apply in these situations. As for the actual process, there are two ways that I know of. The industrial process is to grind up the catalytic converter cores and melt them at extremely high temperature. It needs to be hot enough to melt the ceramic substrates, so around 1500 to 1900 degrees Celsius. Now, while it's molten, a scavenging metal is added, like copper, that dissolves the precious metal particles. This solution of molten copper sinks to the bottom of the molten ceramic and is drawn off. The depleted ceramic is solidified and discarded, and the copper is then electrolytically processed to separate out the precious metals. This process is great on the industrial scale, but it's somewhat beyond the reach of the amateur. The second method I know, which is a bit more accessible to the home chemist, is to grind up the catalytic converter cores and incinerate them to drive off any hydrocarbons that deposit during use. Then they are dissolved in aqua regia and the solution is filtered and concentrated. Various precipitants are added, like ammonia, to precipitate out the precious metals. The precious metal salts are then heated to high temperature to convert them into precious metal dust. You know, I probably have all of the chemicals and equipment to do this, but I don't have any catalytic converter cores. If in the future I acquire some, I might demonstrate this process. Okay, so on to the next question. Antonio asks, how can I separate the potassium chloride from a mixture of potassium chloride and sodium chloride? Okay, let's see now. Actually, this is not too difficult. What you need to know is that sodium chloride has a fairly constant solubility in water, even in boiling water. It does rise a little bit, but not much. Potassium chloride, on the other hand, becomes significantly more soluble in boiling water than it is in cold water, almost double in solubility. So to use this to your advantage, first you need to know what the mass ratio of the sodium and potassium chloride is in your sample. Then you add to boiling water and keep adding until you've reached the saturation point for potassium chloride. At this point, your sodium chloride might be undissolved, but that doesn't matter. You just want your potassium chloride saturated. Then you quickly filter or decant your boiling hot solution and then cool the filtrate. At this point, a small amount of sodium chloride might crystallize out, but a very large amount of potassium chloride will crystallize out as its solubility drastically changes at colder temperature. What you'll get at the end is fairly pure potassium chloride with a very small sodium chloride contamination. Okay, Mark Shyminsky asks, what are your favorite compounds and chemicals to work with? Well, this is a great question, actually. I like a lot. It's very hard to pick a few. I like copper. It's very easy to work with for electrochemistry. Platinum, not because it's valuable, but because it's tremendously useful. The platinum electrode is great for so many things, and platinum catalysts are used in all kinds of industrial reactions. I really like the chemiluminescent compounds, and you've seen me work with them in my Make Glow Sticks videos. In general, like most chemists, I like anything that crystallizes easily. Any chemist that knows what an X-ray diffractometer is knows exactly what I mean. I like 9,10-diphenylanthracene and 9,10-bisphenothylanthracene. Those are fluorescent dyes. There are many, many more chemicals I like. Those are just the ones that I can think of off the top of my head. Let's see now. Jason Black asks, basically, how can you detect cadmium in coca powder at the 1 ppm level in a modest home lab? Bottom line, you can't. As far as I know, a modest home lab cannot detect cadmium down to 1 ppm. You'll need to upgrade your lab. The only method I know of that even comes close is something called anodic stripping voltammetry. Basically, you stick electrodes into your solution and turn the current to plate on whatever new metals are present. Then you gradually reverse the current and plate off the same metals you just plated on. Because the more reactive metals will plate off first, you will see spikes in the current flow that correspond to the metal that plates off at that particular voltage. You can actually create a line graph that shows various spikes, the size of which tells you how much of that metal is present. This analytical technique can actually be done with a homemade potentiostat and homemade electrodes. Of course, if you had a potentiostat, I wouldn't call your lab modest anymore. Let's see now, Martel Devignode, I'm very sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong, by the way, Let's see, S is basically what I would like to see in the ideal hotplate stirrer. I already have a video where I show the inner workings of one particular hotplate stirrer, so I'll just link that in the video description. As for what I want in my ideal hotplate stirrer, I'll just list it right here to save time. It should reach 350 degrees Celsius, preferably 500, but I understand that aluminum becomes soft near that temperature, so I won't push that requirement too hard. For the stirrer functionality, it should have a very strong magnet. I can't begin to describe the troubles I've had with weak magnetic stirrers. Temperature control with an optional external thermometer probe would be great. A digital display showing me the temperature of the plate and the probe would be nice, and the overall design of the hot plate should be spill resistant and anticipate that beakers and glassware can and will break, dumping their contents all over the device. Therefore, it should be immune to fluid entry both around the heater element as well as around the knobs and switches. I've lost numerous plates because fluids got into the knobs and short out the circuits. The internal construction should have no relays or brushes for motors. Basically, nothing can generate a spark, so any flammable gases that happen to be near the plate during operation will not spontaneously ignite, due to sparking anyway. So the circuitry, therefore, needs to be solid state and the motors need to be brushless. Finally, the ideal hot plate stirrer needs to be extremely reliable. It should be able to run continuously for a month, at least, without a breakdown. If you go for years, that'd be great, but Okay, let's see. Keith asks, is there an easy way to recover copper from copper chloride if you don't need to recycle the acid? Yeah, actually, if you don't mind the waste products and don't care about the acids, then the easiest method to get the copper is to add aluminum metal to the copper chloride solution. The copper will deposit out as the aluminum gets oxidized. Keep adding aluminum until the solution is clear. Filter out the copper slurry, and you can remove the leftover aluminum by adding hydrochloric acid that will dissolve the copper. They'll dissolve the aluminum, but not the copper. And then you filter out again, and then you have a relatively pure copper. Okay, let's see now. Deutsche Schuler, sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. What is the difference between phosphorescence, fluorescence, and luminescence? Okay, so first, luminescence is the general term for anything emitting light that's not a black body radiator. So this term encompasses both fluorescence and phosphorescence. As for the difference between phosphorescence and fluorescence, the simple common definition is something that something with fluorescence emits light while you're shining light on it, and phosphorescent substance emits light after you shine light on it. Actually, I have a video on the basic science of fluorescence, which I'll also link in the video description. As for the difference between phosphorescence and fluorescence, this is where things get more advanced and very complicated very quickly. Now, electrons have a property called spin. They're either spin up or spin down. And when you pack them into an atom or molecule, they pack together in pairs with one spin up and one spin down. Like putting together two bar magnets. They have to have opposite ends. So are you with me so far now? Okay, now in fluorescence, you use light to excite an electron to a higher energy state, and then it emits light and falls back down to its ground state. While this is happening, the electron does not change its spin, so this can happen very quickly, within nanoseconds. That's why it seems emission is continuous when you shine light on fluorescent dye, because the emission happens so fast you can't see the delay. Very fast machines, however, can see it. Anyway, that's fluorescence. In phosphorescence, this is where things become interesting. When the electron is excited and in its higher energy state, it can undergo a spin flip and enter a different energy state that we call the triplet state. Exactly why we call it the triplet state is a whole quantum mechanics course in itself, and I won't get into it. But the bottom line is that this electron now has the opposite spin of when it started. Here's the crucial issue now. It can't emit light and drop down into the ground state because the electron it was paired with originally also has the same spin. You can't pair up two electrons with the same spin. It's like putting together two magnets with matching poles. It's a forbidden transition. So this electron is locked in the high energy triplet state. Now quantum mechanics does allow this transition to occur eventually, but it's comparatively very slow to fluorescence. It can take milliseconds to hours, and that's why phosphorescent materials glow after you shine light on them. The light is coming from those electrons finally returning to their ground state. So that's the difference between fluorescence and phosphorescence. Okay, so next question now. ChaosR1024 asks, What is an easy and cheap chemical method to soften very hard water to use for watering potted plants? Okay, so first, I wouldn't worry too much about it. Now granted, I am not a botanist, so I could be completely wrong, but I think plants tend to do very well with limescale in their soil. It doesn't hurt them. If you think it's very unsightly and still want to reduce the limescale, there are a couple of things you can try. You can try and precipitate out the calcium and magnesium responsible by taking a bucket of the water and adding a tablespoon or so of sodium bicarbonate, also known as baking soda, and letting it settle overnight. Then filter out or decant the water. You'll need to experiment with the quantities to find the exact amount that matches the hard water in your area. Now, a better long-term solution is to get a piece of equipment called a reverse osmosis deionization unit. This will actually remove the ions from your tap water and create very pure water that won't produce limescale. This works by pushing water against a semi-permeable membrane under pressure. This membrane lets water through but strongly resists the passage of ions. The nearly pure water then goes through a deionizer unit that removes the remaining ions to give you very pure water. It might seem costly at first, but considering these units can process thousands of liters of water before needing a cartridge replacement, the overall water cost per liter can be cheaper and far less labor-intensive than chemically treating your water with baking soda. I'm actually going to be replacing my existing reverse osmosis deionization unit in my lab with a new one next month, so I'll be making a video on it then. Okay, new question. Chris Palkovich asks, basically how to build a fume hood and why I keep my daddy hidden. Okay, you actually asked two questions here, and I only let people ask one per month. Since you're more interested in knowing why I mask my voice and keep my daddy hidden, I'll answer that. There are lots and lots of reasons, ranging from legal to personal to stupid. So I'll just give you the shortest answer. I want to. Unless we get $10,000 per video on Patreon, which I'm certain will never happen, from now on I'm just going to answer with blatant lies. Whenever someone asks me that or a related question. Okay, so moving on. Roman asks, can you describe several chemicals you won't work with no matter how much you're paid to due to safety concerns? When P asks for patronage, doesn't want to ask questions, blah, 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 blah. Okay. For now, I'm answering all questions, but if in the future there are too many, then I'll start cutting down to just paying questions. Anyway, but as for your question, I will answer it. If you pay me enough, I'll work with any chemical, no matter how dangerous, because I'll just use the money to implement safe equipment and practices. If it's extremely dangerous, then I'll get remote robotics to handle it. This is how the nuclear industry performs chemical separation on spent fuel elements. Alternatively, I might just do what most professors do and hire some grad students instead. Okay, so finally, last question. Simon Bitdiddle asks, perhaps look at some permeable membranes and plastic as part of cheap at-home chemistry. Doesn't sound like a question. It sounds like you want me to suggest you some membranes or something. As far as I know, most domestically available plastics are not suitable for membrane use because the whole point of them is to be impervious to fluids and other things. It'd be pretty goofy if you put Coke in your bottle and the sugar start to leach out the surface. It's got to keep all the Coke in, after all. So with that being said, the membrane on a reverse osmosis unit might be usable for something, so you can probably tear that out. I haven't thought of an experiment to apply to it yet, because that's actually a very sensitive membrane. It's probably limited to what you can do. Another membrane that you might want to try is a cellophane, which is actually used in dialysis tubing. So that might be commentary for the home lab. Finally, it may be possible to make an ion exchange membrane from ion exchange resin. If you can find a suitable way to extrude or cast the resin into thin sheets. As for other membranes, you could probably also buy Nafion online. It's very expensive though, but that's also a membrane you can use. That's all I can think of right now at the moment. That pretty much covers all the questions for this month. So as usual, I will be putting out the question request on Patreon for the next month. So save any questions until you have until then, and thanks for watching. All right, take care, everyone.